So, I've been in China for 16 days, and I've been in Shanghai for 7 days. I don't know why. Usually, I'm a person who's very easily adaptable, like, literally, put me anywhere, and I'm gonna be fine. I just said I'm gonna, and I'm gonna be fine. Yeah. But for some reason, there is something about here, or me being here, that just doesn't feel right. At first, I thought, you know, maybe once I get an apartment, I'm gonna feel normal. I just moved into my cute little apartment today. I don't have bedding, and I'm likely not gonna have bedding until tomorrow, so I'm gonna have to make it work when it comes to how. Bedding tonight, which I don't really care about. It's not really a big deal to me. But I just have this feeling that I might have made a mistake. And I'm hoping to prove myself wrong. But for now, it's just. Yeah, but for now, it just feels like I'm gonna regret this. Okay, that's all I wanted to say. I'm hoping that I feel better. Maybe tomorrow, maybe when I see other people. But for now, I don't feel too good about it. And I don't like this feeling at all. We'll just have to see.
I made that video very, very early on in my Chinese stay or my Chinese life because right from the beginning, from the time I was in quarantine, I always felt like something was off, you know, like I don't know, I feel like something is wrong. And while I was in quarantine, I had that feeling and then I thought, okay, cool, when I get to Shanghai, it's gonna go away. I got to Shanghai and I was staying in a hotel for a week. While I was in that hotel, I still had this feeling, but I thought, you know, maybe when I get my apartment, it's gonna go away. I got my apartment and still the feeling was there. And then I thought, maybe at some point when I'm settled, it's gonna go away. And it never did.
And well, I just feel like this semester you got too many accident, which I don't see good for you. Also not good for the school. You know. And so I just hope you could try to be careful.
Last month, parents actually feel so worried about their teaching quality because the parents, as a substitute teacher, submit to your class and you ask for 2 weeks sick leave. And anyway, we try our best to just calm down, let them just wait. And our efforts actually, we want to just let all the parents know that it's an accident. We don't do it like on purpose. Yeah, we don't want to let our substitute teacher to just have the lesson for your kids and without quality. And we hope to just support our class because without we now our foreign teacher have the accident, so we have no choice.
I am not a superstitious person, but there will always be a part of me that believes that I was just not meant to be in China. COVID started to spread everywhere in China around the 3rd week of December. When that happened, obviously there was panic, and I guess people who had gone through the 2 months Shanghai lockdown earlier that year were probably fearing, you know, the worst. But what ended up happening was when this was happening, we got called into a meeting by G, the vice principal, and she basically told us that, you know, there's a possibility that the school might close and they do not know how long it would close, which is an acceptable answer considering that nobody really knew what was going to happen as far as COVID is concerned. And then remember when I said, you know, like a smart person would have asked for for a COVID-related clause to be in my contract. This was a time where I was like, I should have insisted on that. Because then she went on to say, okay, we would be paid for all of December, even if the school does close. And then if the school is still closed in January, then we would only get paid for 2 weeks. And those 2 weeks were only because that those 2 weeks would be for the Chinese New Year, which in which case the school was going to be closed anyway. But if we're not working for the first 2 weeks in January, then we will not get paid. We tried to protest against this. I think this is one of those moments in which, you know, if there was like unity, maybe something would have happened. This kind of, for me, sent me back to the mindset of, why am I here? Why did I come here? Why did I spend so much money to come here if I'm not going to be able to make money? And January came and then there was no communication from the school whatsoever as to whether or not we were going to work. I had to ask other teachers, okay, guys, what's going on? But other teachers were connected to Teach Online and I was one of those people that were never even sent a message. Like for me, I don't think I would have necessarily minded so much not working, but it was more like, I would really appreciate if there was some kind of communication. In March, I got into a car accident. So one morning I was on my way to work, I was riding a bicycle, and I think I was probably like maybe 2 minutes from the kindergarten. As I was riding, passing by a car, the driver drove into me and hit me. I fell. I was lucky that day because the Chinese traffic officers were also operating on the same street because it was very narrow and they saw the whole thing happen. So as soon as it happened, they rushed across and they came to me and they told me not to touch the bike and they started shouting at the driver. But I couldn't even understand anything that was going on and nobody could speak English. So I ended up calling Janet, introducing a new character, Janet. So Janet is, I don't really know what her position in the kindergarten really was, to be honest, but she was something, you know. She was responsible for like managing the teachers, but I don't really know what her actual position was. But at that point, Janet and I really got along. So I called her so she can come to the scene and, like, you know, translate for me. She walked to the scene and then she translated for me and helped me, like, told me that the cop said it wasn't my fault, it was the driver's fault. And then I said, I need to go to a hospital and I need to be checked. It was the driver's responsibility, like, to take me everywhere, to take me to hospitals, get me x-rayed, make sure that I was, like, there was nothing broken. And there wasn't nothing broken, like, I just had bruises. So I got hit by an SUV and went to a hospital. And then went back to work same day. And I could have gone home, but I went back to work and completed my day. The following day, I couldn't move. Like, my neck was so painful. My body was so painful. And I just texted Janet, because at this point, Janet was like our point of contact, not G anymore. Before Janet, there was G, and then we had Janet to talk to about everything. And I told her, like, I couldn't come to work. And I don't really remember, like, if there was something important at work or something. But I do remember that one of the teachers was from Mexico. He was on parental leave and they had gotten a substitute for him. And this substitute was a guy from Zimbabwe. So I told her I couldn't come to work. And she was, like, literally begging me to come to work. And I was like, I was in a car accident that you saw. It's not even like I'm making this stuff up. And I was just like, I don't care what you do, I'm not coming. And then I went back to work the following week on Monday. Things were okay. Guys, I swear to God, someone was bewitching me. And then April comes. So we were having PE training because apparently before, a year before, the school used to hire an external sports teacher to come and do PE with the kids. And then they decided they didn't want to pay an extra person. They would rather have the English teachers do it, the homeroom teachers do it. So we basically all had to do this PE training. And we, while we were doing this training, we were like jumping on things, we were running. And so there was a stool probably this high, and I jumped on it. And as soon as I landed on it, I think I landed on, because there was someone else behind me and I was in a rush, and I landed and my feet were not level and I sprained my ankle. And I just like walked really fast. And I was like, ouch, ouch. And Tenet was like, do you want us to go to the nurse? And I was like, no, I'm okay, I'm okay. And I really thought I was okay. So, and then I just went about my day. I was like doing everything. And as I'm like doing everything throughout the day, I could feel like my foot is not okay. Not okay at all. But then every time I look at it, it just looks normal. So, and then I keep going. And then I think it was probably around 3 p.m. And I look at it and I'm like, oh my God, my foot is getting swollen. My ankle is getting swollen. But then even then, I'm like, okay, maybe it's not a big deal because I can still walk. It just started to feel a little bit squishy. And then around 3:30, I text Janet and I'm like, I need to see the nurse. Something's wrong with my ankle. And Janet doesn't respond. So at 4 p.m., we take the kids out to the parents are picking up the kids. And I see Janet and I'm like, did you get my text? And she's like, yeah, I was very busy. And I'm like, okay, can we go to the nurse? And then she's like, yeah. So we go to the nurse and I take off my shoe and at this point, my entire ankle is like round. My foot is like really swollen. And then the nurse looks at it and it's like, okay, like there's nothing we can do. We don't have painkillers or whatever. And then Janet just says, no, just go to the, you know, pharmacy, get some patches, put them on your ankle, you're gonna be just fine. But she could see at that point that my foot wasn't okay, but she was still like very dismissive about it, just go to the pharmacy. So I go back to my classroom and then we go home, and we used to walk together with my other colleagues from the kindergarten to the train station. The walk was about 19 minutes or so, and I got to the train. And then I'm sitting down and then I start to feel like, yeah, it's like there's a whole blood flow dance going on there. And I'm like, okay, it's starting to feel not fine anymore. By the time I needed to transfer to a different line, I couldn't walk. I couldn't get up. Helen, who was one of my colleagues, she put me around her neck and then she helped me go to my line. And then obviously she had to go home too, so she left me alone in there. And I was sitting in the train thinking, how the hell am I gonna get out? So I arrived in my station and I was hopping on one leg because at that point my foot was so sore, I couldn't even put my toe on the ground. I couldn't, it was so painful, but I still had to go up the stairs to exit. So I went up the stairs with just one leg and I hopped across the street into my compound, and I lived on the fifth floor of a building with no escalator, with no elevator. And I had to hop all of the stairs into my apartment, and I just got in and I laid in my bed and I texted my co-teacher and I was like, I am in pain. I cannot walk. She ordered me, I still have the spray actually. She ordered me two Chinese spray to spray in my ankle so it could, you know, stop the pain and the swelling. But what was funny about that was at that point I had changed my number for delivery guys to open the door. They would call you and then you would press like the hash on your phone and then the door would open. But I had changed my number so that couldn't happen to me. And so she was texting me. She's like, the guy is at the door. Like, you need to go open the door. And I'm like, I can't walk. And luckily one of my neighbors had opened for the guy and he was there, and I sprained my ankle, woke up the following day and had to take myself to a hospital. I could not walk. It was like a joke. I was laughing at myself because here I was all by myself in an apartment by myself and I can't walk. I can't walk up down the stairs. I can't walk up this. I can't walk anywhere. So I hopped out of the building, went to a hospital, and they did some x-rays and they found that I had a minor fracture in Korea. Doctors were very encouraging of people going back to work, even if they were sick. But in China, this doctor literally was like, you have a fracture, you go stay home for 14 days and rest your foot for 14 days. So I texted my job and I told them that I couldn't come to work. I had so much debate in my head. I even posted this on my Instagram and I was like, okay, doctors told me to stay home for 14 days. I don't know if I should milk the 14 days or if I should go back to work as soon as I feel better. But then I remembered how these people were starting to be and I was like, nope, I'm staying home for the whole 14 days. They got a substitute teacher for me. But here's the thing, they were paying this guy the full like salary for teaching my classes and they also had to pay me because I got injured at work. But every single day, I had to prepare the classes myself. So I would wake up at 7 a.m. every day, sit in front of the computer so that by 8 a.m., I've already sent the material to this guy and he knows exactly what he's gonna teach my classes. Every day, Janet would send me a message asking me, hey Nolu, how are you? How's your foot? Is it okay? And you think, oh, it's so cute, he cares, she cares, but she didn't. She didn't give a crap about me. The only thing she wanted to know every day was, when are you coming back to work? She even went as far as saying, hey, like after like the first week, and she was like, hey, we will hire like an additional teacher to come help you. And I'm like, I work in a kindergarten and I can't walk. How am I supposed to work? Because there's literally like nothing, like the only thing I can do is like sit in front of the kids. How am I gonna get myself there in the first place? Like, how am I gonna get myself from the train station to the school? How am I gonna walk into the classroom? How am I gonna teach 3-year-olds when I cannot walk? I felt bad about staying at home even though I was injured. I stayed at home for 13 days actually. On the 14th day, I went back to work. I was like, okay, cool. I'm tired of like getting Janet's messages about when are you coming back to work. I'm gonna go to work. I still had to wear like an ankle strap just to make sure that my ankle had support. But overall, I could walk. I think it was around May. Parents were gonna come to the school the following week to come and like observe our classes when we were teaching. And so in preparation for that, we had to go to every teacher's classroom and see like their English environment, like their classroom decorations, and give them tips on how to improve it. But the problem was that the school didn't communicate this with us in a proper way. They were basically like, okay, today we are going to do this at 4:20. Mind you, we come to work at 8 a.m. We leave at 4:30 and they were asking us to go to other teachers' classrooms at 4:20. The first day came, we went to one teacher's classroom and then we walked around to see how the classroom was set up. We did evaluation because we had to give them scores on what we thought about their decorations. And then when it was 4:30, it was me, my colleague from Ukraine, my colleague from South Africa, and then we went to one person's classroom, did everything, and when it was 4:30, we all walked out. This was probably one of the most childish things I've ever done, because the way we did it, we couldn't keep quiet on when we were walking out because I was so anxious, and we just started laughing and running down the corridor. And then I think still, they didn't notice that we were gone until they went to a different classroom, and that's when they noticed that we were gone. So then they sent messages to everyone in the group asking why we left. And then the following day, they still came to us and they asked us why we left. The thing about me is I don't really mind staying at work, after the time I'm supposed to be at work. But I want that to be communicated properly with me. And I want you to ask me if it's okay that I can stay. Ask me nice, like be nice about it. You know, I don't want to feel like I'm compelled to stay at work after work when you're not even acknowledging the fact that now you're taking away from my personal time, when you're not even paying me for the overtime that I'm staying. And then Janet was like, well, if you wanted overtime, you could have communicated with it. And I'm like, you guys, it's not about money. It's about you guys communicating this with us in a way that makes us feel like we feel valued. One thing that I forgot to mention was in April, I had a meeting with G about my contract renewal. And because I already knew that I wasn't going to stay, my initial plan was to stay at the school until tell them I was going to renew and then just leave. But then I was like, I feel really bad about this. I don't really want to do it. I want my students to at least get a decent teacher. So I'm going to tell them that I'm not going to renew. And then the school had a Mother's Day event where they wanted to invite mothers to come to the school and prepare flowers and then take these flowers home. But then they were asking the parents to pay a lot of money to participate in a Mother's Day event that was organized by the school. So the moms did not want to come. And they spun this. They spun this and made it seem like now they were doing it for teachers, and they called it Teacher Appreciation Day. So instead of the moms being the ones that were like cutting flowers and arranging them, we ended up being the ones that were cutting flowers and arranging them. And they thought we didn't know that the event wasn't initially made for us and that it was made for the moms. And I say this because it comes into play in some of their reasoning at some later stage. They expected us to do so much work, which I didn't mind, except for the part where they would just bring random things, like, for example, the flower arrangement thing. At that point, we were busy, I think, preparing for something. I don't remember what we were preparing for. And they were basically taking time away from us, forcing us to go to this flower arrangement thing during the time in which you're supposed to prepare for the classes. And I was also doing a lot for my classes, you guys. I used to, they would give us books for the kids to take home so they can write what books they were reading at home. I was one of the very few people who cared about doing that for almost every single kid. I gave homework that was specific to every single kid. I didn't give homework to everybody as a whole. I would observe the kids and how they are performing, and I would alter homework for every single one of my students. I had 20 kids in my class for every single one of them. I had folders in my computer so I can know what homework I gave to which student when and how I can make that different for every single one of them. But I was so frustrated because I felt like nobody was seeing any of the effort that I was putting. It's not that I needed a pat on the back to do my job. It was more like, for example, with the flowers thing where I was like, okay, you guys are taking time away from us, time we could be using to prepare to go do this flower thing. And if you don't show up for this flower thing, then it's a big deal. And then Janet's response was like, you need to work on your time management. We had parents' observation. I think mine was like a Wednesday and a Thursday. I don't remember the dates. Honestly, I'd have to look at the pictures because I have pictures. And on the second day, I was on my way to work and I was riding a bike and it was raining. There were like workers on the road and then there was a car coming and I was trying to not bump into the workers and also not run into the car. I just fell from the bike, but I didn't know it was bad. My hand was bleeding a lot, but I got back on the bike and I rode to work. When I arrived at work, I was like bleeding. My hand was bleeding. And I just went straight to the nurse's room and I was like, okay, I need a Band-Aid. So the nurse, the logistics person, they used to call her Li Lao Shi. She was cleaning my wound so she could put a Band-Aid on it. And then she noticed that there was a stone in my hand. So she tries to get some clippers to take out the stone. And she notices that the stone is like dead, like it's lodged in. And then she's just like, nope, we need to take you to a hospital. I had observation day for the parents that day, but I had to go to a hospital. Like for me, I was like, I'm not in pain. Just like put a Band-Aid on that and then I'll deal with this later. They were like, you're bleeding. It's a big deal. It was more of a big deal when I had fallen from a bike and I could walk and I could use my hands, even though I had a stone in my hand, than it was when I actually couldn't walk. Because when I couldn't walk, they were like, whatever. But when I was bleeding in my hand, they were like, oh, it's a big deal. Like, let's take you to a hospital. That day, Li Lao Shi, a name you should remember, she got in a taxi with me. We went to three different hospitals. The first two hospitals couldn't take my medical insurance that the school provided because it was shit. And then the third one could take it. And so I was there and the doctor was trying to take the stone out. I've never cried in so much pain. I've never experienced so much pain in my life. That day I was screaming. I was like, nope, I cannot do this. They eventually had to like numb my hand and they cut it and they took out the stone. This woman, Li Laoshi, remember her. She held my hand as I was screaming. She held my hand. She covered my eyes when I did not want to see the knife that was cutting through my hand to take out the stone. She took me to the hospital. She was super supportive. She was just there for me in a way that I needed somebody to be there for me. Because I had, again, went to a hospital, went back to work. I went back to work and then she went to the kitchen and made sure that I had eaten and she gave me my medicine, sent me a text saying if I need help, I should let her know. And I was really impressed. I was like, oh my God, she really cares. One of my students was like, my favorite kid was like, why are you always having accidents? But she said it in Chinese and then my co-teacher translated it for me. And I was like, dude, I also don't know. Like, I really don't know. And then my co-teacher, who's Chinese, was like, you know what? When someone is like you in China, we take them to a temple to go pray because clearly something is wrong here. And we just laughed it off. The following day, and I was called into a meeting by Janet and G.
Oh, I didn't check the time. I just got the message, so I thought it was now. She said I should come. She said, could you come? Please come to remote 308 for one-on-one meeting today. She just said today. She didn't say time. No. Yeah, I need to change this and I've got stitches, so I have to get the stitches removed in 2 weeks.
How's your parents' alteration?
Pretty good.
Did any of the parents talk with you?
Nope. Because we had class afterwards. We still had to kind of wrap up the kids. So as soon as the class was done, Trista told them they can go. So none of them requested to talk to me.
Okay.
Yeah.
Phonics class.
I did a phonics class on Tuesday, and then I did, cause we were, Helen and I decided not to do the party time part of the text because it's too easy for this week. And then, so we did transportation along with Unit of Curry, so same topic, just like more in English context, yeah.
Hello.
How's your hand?
It's doing okay.
Thank you.
So you are going to hospital again next week?
They said if the nurse here can
check the wound. Oh, so you need to remove their stitches, right?
Not next week. I just have to change this. And then they will pin the wound for me. So I think I will do it here or do it myself. And then when I remove the stitches, I will have to go to the hospital.
Yeah. So next week you have no plan to ask for sick leave, right?
No.
Okay. So how about your, just a reflection about this week's observation?
Parents didn't complain much about anything other than pay more attention to the shy, quiet kids.
Mm-hmm.
That was pretty much the only thing that they said. Apart from that, most of them gave really good feedback.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So, because the last week, actually, we hope you can have the 3 days teaching in the class. Yeah, but it's an accident, so we cannot expect too much, right? Actually, on Wednesday, I talked with parents about
mm-hmm.
their feedback.
Mm-hmm.
And also, I explained to them about the accident.
Mm-hmm.
They could understand, but some of their parents do have some like emotion. Yeah, because they think it's they pay a lot and just want to see our foreign teachers' lesson, and
for that sick parents, maybe they have they didn't receive this recording sheet because for another 2 days we have the recording sheet, right? And they already give some feedback. Yeah, about their teaching strategy and their instruction skills and also for the interaction with the students. Yeah. And some of the parents give some feedback and also have the comment here. Like here. Give you some comments. Yeah. You see.
Oh, let me see.
Some of in English and some of in Chinese. Yeah.
Yeah.
They still hope we can give more interaction with kids, you see. For some of parents, you see, here, interaction, yeah. And interaction during their teaching time is very important for them. Some of parents just give me such oral information, yes. Yeah, also give more time to for them to practice, practice their English, oral English, and also for their vocabulary, and give them opportunity to speak. Just encourage them. That means using more positive language to encourage them to have their better performance. Yeah, better more performance. And maybe some of their kids maybe they cannot manage themselves, but some of parents do think teachers should interfere with such kind of a condition. Yes. So how could you just make their improvement for next time?
Allow the kids to speak more. I mean, we only have 30 minutes for class, so most of the time, 30 minutes just isn't
minutes,
enough.
Just
isn't enough. Because most parents want to see their kids speaking, and we can't literally give every kid, 19 kids, every single one of them a chance to speak in 30 minutes. It's just not impossible. Because then, when you give every single one of them to speak, then the other kids get bored. Like, if you have to speak to every single one of them, so, yeah.
So, could you have any like skills? Maybe you can have more time to involve them during the whole day, because actually for 30 minutes actually it's not enough for parents. They only see that 30 minutes, right? So do you have any other plan during the whole day, like integration?
I mean, I see at least one of them. I have one-on-one English reading with each and every one of them for those that come early on time. I always do my English reading in the morning with one-on-one with the kids, never with just them as a group, because the reason why I don't do it as a group is because I want to see what each kid is able to do by themselves. Are they able to say anything? Are they able to say, for example, with phonics, are they able to identify alphabets? Do they know the alphabet sounds? So whenever I do my morning readings, I do it with one of them, which is the chance to actually get to know their level and their level of performance. So
yeah, for morning reading, actually for the this program, actually for their reading log, yeah, because every week we should just remind parents and let them bring their log book back, and so we can read with them in the morning, right? And do we have any, like, because the last time it's a just the reading book checking, right? So I saw some of their parents have some recording for their kids. Actually parents hope teacher can have more recording for them.
It's impossible to read multiple books at the same time when you only have 30. I have 30 minutes, so my morning reading starts at 8:20. It used to start at 8:30, and we move it to 8:20 because we have to be out of the classroom by 8:50. So it's impossible to read multiple books per kid, or to read, like, again, as I mentioned, I use the time to check their progress, to check if they, I give them homework, every single one of them, and I use that time to check if they've done homework. Do they do any practice at home? And do they know, like, alphabets? Do they know the stuff that we're teaching in class while everyone else is in there? So I use that time to check individual programs. Most of the time, progress. Most of the time, I don't even read a book to them. I read a book with them, or I will review the materials that we've done in class during that time, because that's the only time I have with them one-on-one. That's the only time I can check is this kid making any progress? Is this kid able to say anything? Can this kid identify the things that we are talking about in class? So that's the only time. So most of the time, I cannot record multiple books because it's impossible.
So how about like we can write the comments for them? Like we can have some suggestion for parents.
We have the
one block for teacher's comments in our teacher's signature.
I have certain comments with certain kids, but I stopped doing that because there's usually no time to do that. So like, for example, we finish at 8:15. By that time, they're already lining up to go outside and play. And then by the time we come back, I have class. And then we have unit for inquiry, which is the time that I usually use to record homework and send it homework. So whenever I have a suggestion, I can show you my homework files. Whenever I have a suggestion for certain parents, which some of them don't even read, I have files on my folder. I say, okay, this is what we did today. This is what I'd like you to focus on. Can you please do this? Mark certain pages. And I give clear instructions on what they show in each page. Most parents do it. Some parents don't even do it. Some parents don't even look at the book, at the school bags to check if they brought their books back. Some parents have never even written a single thing on their English logs. So like, how many times can you remind adults to do the same thing? Like, there's only so much that we as teachers can do as well.
Mm-hmm. There's only so much. You cannot just.
Yeah, I can show you in the. I have a folder in the shared folder that is like, for every single kid, mm-hmm. I have individualized, because I don't give homework in general. I have individualized homework based on their progress, based on what they know. Like, because I don't want them to redo the same things that they already know how what to do. So, for example, if a kid knows the difference between A, B, C, D, then I will give them something different to focus on. So I try to do that I do it for every single one of them. And certain parents will look at it and they will send me messages if they don't understand something. Okay, you gave me homework and I don't really know what to do. Like, how can I do this? And then I tell them. Certain parents will know by themselves. Certain parents just don't care.
They don't care. So.
They don't look at it. They don't do it. They don't bring the books. They don't bring the reading logs. They don't write anything on the reading logs. Like,
yeah, for some of parents who don't care, actually, only in this time,
mm-hmm.
because they are still in K1. Mm-hmm. But when they move to upgrade to K2 and K3, parents will feel so nervous and because they need to face the challenge from the primary school. So when upgrade to next level, after some parents will feel, yeah, maybe they think our teachers should remind them earlier, and then you should push my kids and I have more.
Yeah, one of the things that I've been trying to do with them, which was sort of like to prepare the kids for like K2, is give them writing homework. So in the books, they have alphabet tracing homework. But you know what the parents do when they get it? They write themselves on the book. And you can tell that there is no way a kid has written that. They write on the books themselves and they just bring the homework back, which just defeats the whole purpose. Because again, I don't have time to sit with every single kid and then have them write. And most of the time we don't have time for any sort of writing or whatsoever, because most of them cannot write. So what I do is, for example,
mm-hmm.
I will have my morning reading on Monday and I have four kids and I give homework to those four kids. That means they have from Tuesday up until the next Monday to do the homework.
Mm-hmm.
That gives them ample amount of time to read books and record them on the reading log, to do the homework and then have it done by the next week. Some parents, as I said, do it. And some parents, you can tell that the kid has written on the book and not them. They will record the reading logs and they will have the kids write and they will have the kids do the homework. Some parents just do the homework themselves and they don't write anything on the reading log and they just send the books back. I send their workbooks with them almost every single time, and it's like the same thing happening all the time. So it's like, you can't really what else am I supposed to do? Go to their houses and like tell them to do the homework? At this point, I'm just like, okay, cool. I'm going to continue to send them reminders, continue to send them homework, and just hope that they do it.
So how can we use our time to just practice with kids, those of the kids, maybe using all our corner playtime, and after maybe they have their snack, right? Mm-hmm. So maybe some of the kids can finish their snack quickly, so we can use that time just to let them, invite them, and chew in the corner.
When is that? Is that in the morning or in the?
In the morning or afternoon? Because afternoon we have their also have the afternoon snack.
In the afternoon, usually they have a class immediately after the snacks. In the mornings, that's when I have my morning waiting time. During the time where they come in and they do that, they have a snack, and then I have my morning reading time with them.
Yeah, because I saw some of our teacher using such kind of the corner time, and if these kids cannot catch up with the pace, and then invite him or her to come to any corner and also finish their work one by one. Yeah.
I do that in the morning too. Every single morning, as I mentioned, I do that, and then I give them homework every single day. Every single one of them, their homework is different from the other most of the time. But again, it's like there's only so much you can do with the time that we have.
Because it's not just a matter of the homework. I mean, some of parents just care, you know.
But it's
yesterday.
One thing.
Yesterday, I show our parents to visit our class, mm-hmm. because your class have the parents, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I didn't. Enter into your class and just outside through the window, and our parents actually they hope to see more just like their interaction with the kid, yeah, and not just our teaching words, and that means they hope have more practice for their kids, yeah, more game for their kid, because they only kid one, yeah. The kind of the suggestion from that visitor's parents, because I just show her your class, yeah, out of the window, yeah. Because your parents inside, so I didn't leader that visitors inside of your classroom, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Do you guys have corner playtime?
We have playtime in the morning and afternoon. Usually, like as I said, they wake up. And they have their snack, and then they get prepped for the next class, and then after that.
I don't think after snack is a good time, but if you have a corner time,
yeah.
If they go to different corner and play, you could use.
That's usually in the morning, which is when I do my morning reading, as I mentioned.
Oh, that's the same time.
Yeah, that's the same time.
So after English lesson, and then there's unit inquiry.
They do different corner, and then lunch, and then and then they nap.
So in the morning. Corner play your English reading time at the same time, and
yep.
then go out.
They
access.
Go out, yeah, after
then
that,
back.
And then
half
come back,
hour,
and then
hour.
Immediately English after that.
Half an hour, right?
Playtime is
English, and then your unit inquiry.
Inquiry, and
then
lunch time.
And then afternoon snack, and then they have.
And then
lesson.
They have class. Yeah.
So either it's your lesson or.
Or Adele's class.
Oh, Adele's. Mm-hmm. Yeah, your assistant.
So before dismissal, any other time for the one by one?
Yeah, usually during dismissal, that is when we are preparing them, helping them prepare to go home. And most of them will have after school classes. And then after that, and that's when I usually will consolidate their homework to put them in their backpack so they can take it home.
Mm-hmm. Anyway, I just let you know parents' feedback, especially yesterday that visitors. I explained to her after it's a K-1, so we have the parents' observation week. So our teacher should finish the lesson during just 30 minutes. So we have the very tight schedule for them. So maybe we have no enough time for parents to practice their oral English. Yeah, and the teacher will finish all this lesson one by one. Yeah. Okay, so last time, because I sent you about the message about the backup plan, you know, parents support your class nearly half of the month, right? Because you asked for 2 weeks of sick leave, right? And it's a really embarrassed, because when parents ask me, what's K1's lesson plan? What's the teaching material?
I don't know, every single day.
Yeah, I send you the message and
every single day I sent him the material. Every single day I did the lessons all myself. I prepared the PPT myself. I told him what the games are. I told him what worksheets that he needed to print out. I sent messages to the group that you and I and him are in.
Maybe the first day.
I even created a folder. Literally, every single day I told him what to do. I would wake up every single day before 8 to make sure that he had materials to teach before that he actually had a class. And I would actually tell him specifically when he was using the textbook, which pages in the textbook that he needed to teach.
Yeah, maybe on the first day or maybe the first day, it should be Tuesday, and maybe it's a little bit rush, right? So when I ask you about some of the lesson plan for today or this week, is that P or which one? Oh, it should be the daily plan, and you told me actually you didn't prepare the details for that because you are at home, it's not convenient for you to access to our shared
folders.
And I did.
Right. And I sent all the materials.
Yeah, actually all these plans should be finished 1 week earlier. That means by Thursday, all the weekly plan should be over there. All the teaching material should be over there. So for the substitute teachers, actually it's easy to support your class. Yeah, I just let you know Karen's feedback, because that Tuesday it's a really rush for parents and a really rush for us. Yeah, because I connect to you for all the teaching materials. And left 3 days, actually, we chat group, and you send that materials in that group, right? Yeah. So I hope all the lesson plans should be finished, just like today and Friday, and actually the next week, the plan, all the teaching materials, we can build a folder, and then we can just have all the material together. And because normally Friday, I will check all the lesson plan, also the teaching materials, yeah. And currently, actually for the K-1, I can see some of the plan, but for the others' plan, like the detailed one, I hope not just the lesson plan, hope put the teaching materials and also the worksheet and together in the same folder. So some of the teacher ask for sick leave or just for some emergency things, so we can find all the materials very quickly. So I hope next time we can have such a systematic folder, all the material inside.
I mean, we try to use the prep time that we are given to prep materials, but we don't always have a lot of time to do that. For example, this week there was just so much stuff that needed to be done, and then on Monday we spent an entire afternoon, which was supposedly our prep time, doing the training, which meant that it's pretty much every single time an afternoon is taken away from us. For example, right now, like, I should be preparing for Monday, right? But I'm here, which means I'm not prepping.
Not just for next Monday. Actually, this yesterday you should prepare all their daily plan for next week.
It's only an hour
yeah.
and a half. There's only so much you can do in an hour and a half. There's only so much you can do in an hour and a half.
Yeah, normally Friday is a busy day. I could understand. Yeah. I just let you know our school's like a plan, so we could we can manage all the steps, because if one teacher cannot do like that, maybe some of the teachers will think, oh, it's just her.
I mean, there's like difference between expectations and reality. Like, expectations is okay, this is what it's expected to do, but in reality it's not possible to do that.
Yeah, if in reality there is some like a complication, we could understand that, yeah, a special condition. So I hope we should have more like positive communication, and can let me know your difficulties and also your opinions. I feel a little bit embarrassed, because I saw a lot of I don't know, it's a complaining message or what in the WeChat group. And when I say we should using our time wisely, and so we can join our team building meeting, just last week we have the Mother's Day, right? and for flower arrangement, like team building, as a team building. So when you send that message, Roger this, I couldn't understand. So
it means
what's this?
I understand.
It's really impressed me. Yeah.
Why?
I hope to encourage all the foreign teachers to
But
attend that
Roger, that means I got it. It simply means I got the message you sent. I was acknowledging that you sent a message to the group and I was saying I got it. That's what Roger that means.
So I could understand that. Maybe you should let me know. Oh, okay, just we will got it. We will attend that meeting. So maybe...
Because I also honestly feel like you see us constantly saying that, like, for example, Gosha and I raised the fact that we were using the time.
Yeah,
to,
I saw
like, yeah,
Gosha's,
yeah, we were pretty much talking about the exact same thing, which is, this is the prep time. Actually, that event last week was very spontaneous. Like, it was sort of like, out of nowhere, suddenly you have to do the team building. Like, that is something, if it was planned, that is something we could have known a week prior to know that it was happening. It was the same thing about the training this Monday. Nobody told us a day, like the week before, that we had training. We got told on the day that we have training.
Mm-hmm.
You know, every single time that happens, that totally inconveniences us in terms of planning. Like, this week was a very stressful week with the parents coming and you think, okay, cool, I'm going to use my prep time maybe to cut this, to eliminate that, to do that, to do
that.
Yeah,
I saw you.
And the next thing...
You do some preparation work during the training.
Next thing
yeah.
you have...
I want to remind you and Hannah.
And next thing you have, you're told on the morning of that this afternoon there's a training. Wasn't this training known prior to Monday? Like, it would have been helpful to know the week prior that we have a training on Monday so that we know we have a training on Monday, not to be told on the day that we have training on Monday, which means now, okay, so everything that we had planned on doing that afternoon now has to be scrapped.
Mm-hmm.
We have to try and kind of take time here, take them here, you know? And that's extremely stressful. That's exactly what Gosha and I were trying to mention last week, that we have a team building meeting. Great, we have to prep our English corners for other teachers to evaluate our English corners, but we just got told that now we have to do this, which is very inconvenient. So it's not about complaining. It's about, if these things were known to us in advance, then we would know how to plan properly in advance so that nobody complains about these things. Nobody would complain about a meet knowing that there's going to be a meeting if they know prior. But to be told the day before or the day off is extremely inconvenient.
Yeah, I could understand your suggestion, what you said.
But I felt like you didn't understand it because your response was... time management is the basic skill for everybody. That was your response. Should be a basic skill for everyone.
Actually, it's a basic skill.
It's a basic skill.
I didn't highlight any negative things.
It's a basic skill
yeah.
only if you have time. I mean, we only have 8.5 hours here. So in those 8.5 hours, there's a billion things we try and get done in those eight and a half hours. So anything that is thrown spontaneously into that 8.5 hours is a total inconvenience, especially if it wasn't told prior. And you get told in a day that you have training for like for 2 hours. That means literally your day now has to be squashed into 6 hours because you have to try and make it work in those 6 hours. So sometimes the Chinese teachers get frustrated too because they feel like we're not being too involved. But we're like, okay, so we have to do this, we have to do that, we have to write this. For example, I have folders due today. I have folders due today, and that means like for the next 30 minutes to an hour, I have to be like, I had to work at home, mostly because I did not acknowledge that, okay, I had an accident at work, so I have to take work home. But if I can help it on any other normal week, I don't want to do work at home. I don't want to do that. I have 8.5 hours that's here. I want to utilize those 8.5 hours here to do my work here. So I don't like it when something is spontaneously thrown into my day that totally inconveniencing. That means I cannot be as present as I would like to be in my class. I cannot be as full as I would like to be because now I have to try and squeeze my time into multiple things while also trying to meet the deadlines. I've never not... submitted stuff on a deadline, even if it meant I had to stay here until 10 p.m. But I'm not trying not to do that right now. So anything that is spontaneous is totally inconvenient. It's not a matter of whether or not you have time management skills. It's whether or not you actually do have the time in reality to do whatever it is that you're supposed to do, which sometimes is not the case.
Yeah, actually for when, because you already mentioned our team building, like flower arrangement last week. Actually, it's school actually want to just give our teacher a surprise. That's why we have such a, sudden news. And also for Chinese teachers. So all the Chinese teachers, they didn't know what will we have. Yeah, what we already prepared for them. So they didn't know that. So we just want to give all the teachers a surprise. It's a Mother's Day party, just like that. So when we, because a foreign teacher, our foreign teacher maybe, actually on the second day, right? And the first day, Chinese teacher, and we also told Chinese teacher, please don't tell foreign teacher about this team building party, and we hope to give them a surprise. So that's why that day I sent that message.
But you sent it the day before, so that when the Chinese teachers went there, we already knew what they were going there because you sent the message that day, so it wasn't really a surprise. We already knew
what
we were doing there.
Actually, maybe some of the foreign teachers already know, but actually from our inmost heart, we want to give all the teachers a surprise. We already prepared the flower. We bought flower from the market and also setting the table for all the teachers. Actually, we just want to just energize our teachers. Actually, for kindergarten, actually the working is very, it's very busy.
I can
understand. Yeah, it's very tough. But we still need such a kind of their flexibility and our positive attitude to us, such kind of the sudden news or like change. Yeah, it's so that's why it's a basic skills. Yeah, but normally we should have their normal routine. Yeah, we can. That's why we will send out our lesson plan. Hope just we can follow all the routine. Yeah. And all the meeting planning and also our event, like the observation week. We hope send it this arrangement, one day earlier, yes.
Mm-hmm. Maybe if we have like training, we could be told like the week prior or as soon as the planning is finalized, okay, mm-hmm. On this day next week, you're gonna have training so that we know,
Yeah, because we still need to just confirm with the training center for their schedule, because they fly to Shanghai and or maybe they take the train to Shanghai. We still need to have a double confirm for them. Okay, yeah. So anyway, we will have the plan for all this kind of training. Hope we can send this training schedule earlier. And I'll just let you know, next Monday, should be the next Monday and Tuesday, we are planning for a foreign teacher about kids a STEM training for the summer camp. Yeah, but I still need to check with the training center for that. Yeah, for that schedule. So when the schedule fixed, okay, their trainer can come to here and have all the materials for demo, and they will just fix the time and fix the date. And so I will just put all this training schedule in our weekly plan, working plan, yeah. Mm-hmm. And because you already mentioned about the let me think, you actually you have some your own plan, right? So what's your planning for the next semester?
It's just moving on.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I've already got a plan that's set, so it's a good thing.
Okay.
I just saw your nail.
Mm-hmm.
Kindergarten teacher is a little bit too long.
It's what?
Too long. A little bit long. You know, because you got Q1, just want to remind you. Because for all kindergarten teachers.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, for Chinese teacher, we even require them to do colors. But I think for foreign teachers, it's okay to do colors. We try to keep it that long because it's not convenient.
Yeah, my nails don't really get in the way, to be honest. Yeah.
Yeah.
current should be okay, but too long maybe it's not to safe for
I haven't stopped anybody.
For yourself and for kids.
And so not safe, you know, for your kids. Your kids.
Nobody has been stopped by my nails.
And how's your kids now? Because, you know, in the beginning I know your kids' situation.
My kids are great, honestly. Still have two that are very that I don't think will change anytime soon, because I feel like there's nothing we can do in our classroom to try and get them to behave a certain way. They just are the way they are, and I think their parents know. But apart from them, everyone else is just grown up like a lot, and they are able to sit down and keep quiet. They know instructions. They know the threats work on them. Yeah, they're really good, really good.
And how's their English right now? They
understand a lot. They're getting more confident. Some of them are more confident than others in speaking. Obviously, we still have some that don't understand the basics. And I feel like also parents could play a role in that. But most of them, comprehension is pretty good. Some of them are able to speak basic things. And they follow, almost all of them follow instructions very easily now. Like, I don't have to have any explain something. Like, even with the games, it's just like one instruction and I show them once and they understand how the game works. Speaking, some of them still have a long way to go, but some of them, those who had basics when I started with them, have gotten a lot more confident. So, yeah.
Okay. So, I know
their
listening comprehension probably.
Yeah, it's very good. Very, very good.
Speaking, some of them can speak.
Yeah, some of them can, like a lot of them can speak. A lot of them can understand the basics. So pronunciation is still quite a problem even when they try to speak with some of them. But say maybe you've got like two or three that are not able to speak much, or rather maybe they're shy to say anything. So because I always try to get, like, whenever I have one-on-one conversation with them, I always ask them basic questions like, what's your name? Like, how old are you? How are you? And see how they are able to respond. Are they able to understand the question? Can they say something? So I think some of them is also like a confident issue where they feel like whatever it is that they say is going to be wrong. So they become a little bit shy. So I always try to encourage them to speak regardless. But yeah.
And how's their reading?
Basic phonics sounds as far as it goes, but most of them cannot read. Yeah. Yeah, we don't really focus on reading in K1 anyway, so I just teach them so they know the basics of the phonics sound, so that when they do get to a point where they are able to like make like consonant blends in order to read, then they'll just be able to know the difference. Yeah.
Okay. And what about your semester, you got too many accidents, which I don't see good for you, also not good for the school. You know, and so I just hope you could try to be careful.
Last month, parents actually feel so worried about their teaching quality, because the parents, as a substitute teacher, submit your class, and you ask for 2 weeks sick leave. And anyway, we try our best to just calm down, you know, let them just wait. And our efforts actually, we want to just let all the parents know that it's an accident. We don't do it like on purpose. Yeah, we don't want to let our substitute teacher to just have the lesson for your kids and without quality. And we hope to just support our class, because without we now our foreign teacher have the accident, so we have no choice. Yeah, sometimes parents will give us a lot of pressure. Why so many accidents happen in our class? Why so many accidents? So it's another pressure for us. And another way, because we still want to just have the time to help our foreign teacher to improve our teaching quality. That's why creates a lot of opportunity to for foreign teachers, and including Chinese teachers, to have more sharing between different classes. That's why last week we arranged a classroom environment sharing, like first Chinese teacher have their Chinese language corner, and then the whole classroom setting, and also for English corner environment sharing. So last time, actually, for the second day, actually, we have all the teachers together go to the K2B. It's very good. But after 4:30, I saw only four foreign teachers left and have such the whole session for this sharing. So I don't know what happened to that condition. And even no positive communication with me, and just put that that feedback evaluation form on that table. And now when we finish the K2B sharing, when we turn around, oh, where are they? And Taylor and I just guess, oh, they already moved to K3A and K3B. When we go there, nobody there. So it's really just, we feel just, it's unrespectful. Yeah, so please, if it is okay, you know, you can think, actually it's our non-working time, and you can let us know, and we even will have very positive communication with all the foreign teacher. Even this, we can have the overtime work application, and you know, this Tuesday, we have the children class for pre-KB, right? And our parents come to our pre-KB for that children class. And actually, I didn't tell Lainey and also Casey about overwork time. And we need to finish this class for the new parents and their kids. And actually, they communicate with parents and are very carefully. And when parents leave, it's already 6 p.m. So I feel so touched. So I talk with Casey and also Lainey. Okay, I think I didn't told you about overworking time. So I have to apply for at least 1 hour overtime for you. And I talk Oscar and also talk Jiahuan. Please record it. We should encourage this positive behavior. Yeah, because they just show their patience to parents and to their kids for this children class. It help our school. Yeah, just upgrade our reputation. Yeah, so I really feel so, it's a responsibility. It's our working attitude. Yeah, but for last week, something happened. I just feel, because also Taylor told us, actually we should have all the teachers come together, because it's a classroom, not just for Chinese teachers, it's for all the teachers, because it's a class cooperation between Chinese teacher and our foreign teacher. They should co-work together. Yeah, so I don't know what happened to that time.
I think,
I know it's not your working time.
I think it's a matter of communication in that situation as well, you know, because I think the reality of saying we are going to start doing this at 4:20 when we're supposed to do it, we leave and go back home at 4:30 meant that it wasn't going to be done by 4:30. So I think on my part, I'm not speaking on behalf of everyone else, on my part, I would have appreciated the acknowledgement of, okay, by the way, this might go past 4:30, but would appreciate it if you stayed longer. But there was no acknowledgement of that whatsoever, but rather that tomorrow everyone should come, no exception whatsoever. Like for me, that means you as my boss are pushing me to do this thing without acknowledging the fact that it might be an inconvenience for me. I would have appreciated saying, okay, we're going to start at 4:20. It wasn't that I was expecting to get paid overtime. I simply wanted the fact that I was going to stay at work beyond 4:30 to be acknowledged, because after 4:30, I'm not supposed to be here, so I would have appreciated, okay, so it might take longer, just so you know, it might take longer. So I would appreciate it if you stayed until it finishes. It wasn't a matter of money. It was a matter of
I acknowledge it. So knowing that my time, my personal time was not acknowledged and that I felt forced to be there, I felt obliged to only be there until the time I was supposed to go home. And that's what I did. I'm speaking on my behalf, not
yeah,
everyone
actually,
else.
Last week, we only need
another
extra 20 minutes because we finished this sharing before 4:15.
Yeah, again, acknowledgement, you know? So it's not about money. It's more about knowing that I don't work beyond 4:30, but hey, guys, we are doing this. We'd appreciate it if you stayed until it finished. We don't know how long it would last. We know that it's your home time. We'd really appreciate it if you stayed until it finished. But it felt more like, this is your duty. You're supposed to do it. Go and do it. And so that's what we did. We went and we did it during the time that we are supposed to be at work. And as soon as that was done, we went home.
Yeah, actually, on our contract, we also have such a word for we were used our non-working time for our open day and our team building time. Maybe you know last time we have their parenting sports day, right? It's a actually the weekend. Yeah, so we
yeah.
still need some
but
some
yeah,
kind of their
yeah again that was
communicate
that was
yeah.
Again, it's not about not wanting to support. Again, it's more like it's a Saturday. You guys found a way to compensate those teachers who went to work on Saturday, right?
Yeah,
that was the case. So again, it's not about money. It's more about acknowledging that this might be an inconvenience to you, but I appreciated that you're doing this, you know, rather than saying that go do this. It's that's the difference in communication in that.
So I think maybe you already misunderstand what I said. I
mm-hmm.
think we should have the positive communication. If you have such kind of their
mm-hmm.
Needs, please let me know. And so I can, maybe it's not the right time for you and
mm-hmm.
We can just reschedule our time. Maybe we can using our corner time and we can go to a different classroom using that time to finish their only for English corner sharing.
Yeah, I get
yeah,
that.
So
you know, again,
yeah.
Like it would be much more easy, I guess, if we
not just after 4:30.
Yeah, as I said, it would be much more easier if certain things that could
mm-hmm.
potentially be inconveniencing teachers were discussed prior to decision making, because we were not involved in the decision making of the timing last week. We were just told that this is going to happen at this time. We were told, okay, so on this day we're going to be checking teachers' English corners at 4:10. On this day we're going to be checking teachers' English corners at 4:20. That was never a prior discussion with us.
Actually,
that, about that.
You know, for the school's arrangement, actually, it's
mm-hmm.
a time schedule. It's very tight. So we hope all the teachers can come together. Not
again,
just
if that
course.
Wasn't going to
yeah.
be the case, as I mentioned, if that wasn't going to be, if there was no time for discussion and there was
mm-hmm.
no other convenient time and acknowledgement of the fact that it might go over time would have been great.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Just a simple acknowledgement would have been great. Like, okay, so we're going to start at this time. We might finish after 4:30. Again, we will appreciate it if you come. That would have been gone a long way, because one of the most important things as an employee is not about whether or not you work overtime or you don't. For me, it's I care about money because, I mean, everyone needs money, but I don't care about money if I feel like as an employee in this job, I feel appreciated, I feel heard, I feel seen. Then if I have to stay like an extra 30 minutes a day, I don't mind, because this job treats me so well that this is not like, again, even communication is so clear that I don't mind doing it once, or I don't mind doing it every now and then. But when I feel like I'm voicing myself out as an employee, I'm saying this, I'm trying to get this acknowledged, but I don't feel heard, I don't feel seen, then even a single minute staying overtime is already an inconvenience for me, because I'm like, I don't feel like I'm heard. I don't feel like my opinions matter in this place. You already feel like it's an inconvenience. So last week it was a matter of like, again, with the inconvenience that came with while us trying to voice a prep time when we had to go do the team building, to then miscommunication that happened when Helen and I had to do our
our corner time to basically being told like everyone has to be here tomorrow, no exception, at 4:20, then it's like I feel like I'm talking, but I feel like I'm not heard. And because of that, it makes it difficult for me to do any sort of favors.
So I think maybe next time you can just have the suggestion. Yeah, if something not clear, and you can have the double check with me. Yeah, so it's a good way for communication, positive communication. And not, I suppose you should have such kind of arrangement. Just a suppose, personal suppose. Yeah, so if any, you know, if any positive communication comes out, we should just keep the frequent communication. Not just, I think you arrange this schedule like that. And if this schedule is not nice for me, okay, I can ignore it. So I think it's not a good way for
it. We were not ignoring it. Yeah. We're acknowledging it during the time that was acknowledged. We acknowledged it for the time that we were supposed to be at work. And then after that, we left. It's not we didn't ignore it.
Yeah, I just let you know what I feel from last week, because actually first day, maybe during the meeting, you didn't, I think not just you, foreign teacher, maybe some of the foreign teacher already get my point.
Mm-hmm.
They stay for the whole session, for the first day's environmental sharing. The second day, I made a very clear information for that. All the teachers should together, and we should finish all this sharing from K2B, K3A, and K3. Yeah, I think the message is very clear, and I just said we should all finish this session, and for the second day it's very clear, and I hope it's just, I also highlight the purpose. I want to just increase the communication between different classroom, and so all the teachers can learn from each other. Just the purpose. I'll highlight the purpose. If not, I just want to waste your time, right? So if any like misunderstanding, please let me immediately. Yeah, I think it's when you work in a team, and if you think, oh, you are the manager, and I'm just an employee, I think it's not good thinking, because actually here, everybody are employees. You can check with Jean. Okay, I'm an employee too.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so we should just co-work together and support our school, support our board, headquarters, just like that. Yeah. Okay, I have nothing to say.
I can go, right?
Yeah. Thank you for your time.
Oh, there's a lot of
light.
Yeah.
Oh,
thank you.
All right.